Palo Alto Networks is the cybersecurity vendor of choice for nearly 100,000 organizations worldwide, protecting hundreds of millions of people. This makes us a top target for cyber attacks. My name is Peter Havens, and I welcome you to join us in this discovery series where we will explore how Palo Alto Networks Security Operations Center is protecting our company and our people and learn how we do it.
And we are back for another session of This Is How We Do It, where we talk about how Palo Alto Networks people, process, and technology helps keep Palo Alto safe. Today, we have a really exciting topic. We're going to be talking about artificial intelligence, and I'm joined by Yoni Allon, the VP of Research for Cortex. Yoni, thank you for joining me.
Thank you.
Tell us a little bit about you and your team and what you guys do here.
So I lead the research team for Cortex, which builds all the capabilities for detection and protection and some capabilities for analyst experience and automation for the product, including, of course, AI, which is the subject we're going to talk about today.
Yeah.
And what we're doing is we're looking at how threat actors operate, and based off of that, we're building detections and protections that are leveraging, again, AI capabilities to make the product more efficient at blocking and detecting those activities.
Mm. Pretty critical stuff, and I think unique to this series, you're not just focused on helping keep Palo Alto Networks secure, but all the technology that you and your team is doing really helps keep all of our customers secure as well. So thank you for everything you do. Maybe we can just start and talk about artificial intelligence at a high level. Can you just give us your definition? Like, how would you define AI? What is it really in your own words?
So that's a controversial question where I think there's a lot of opinions. And I'll give you mine. And I think mine, again, it's my own opinion. It's not something that represents the entire industry or something like that. But when you're looking at AI as a general term, I would define it as any algorithm that adapts to new data and changes to accommodate that. Meaning that if it's, let's say, one if that says if malicious is bad, then that's probably not AI. That's more of a signature or you know, some logic. I wouldn't call that AI. But with some level of complexity or with a lot of data sources coming in and changing over time, an algorithm that can adapt to that, at some point I would call that AI. And there's a distinction here between AI and machine learning or ML, where ML specifically is not just any algorithm that adapts to new data. It's a specific algorithm that was generated by another algorithm, meaning that you push data into an algorithm and that results in a new algorithm that can potentially adapt to new data as it comes. And that's where the differentiation lies. So AI might be man-made, might be machine-made.
Right.
But the general broad term is, you know, still AI.
Mm-hmm. So thank you for helping us kind of understand the nuance between ML and AI. But I think the key aspect that you mentioned is the algorithm would be considered AI really if it has the ability to adapt or to change as the data is seeing is changing or evolving, correct?
Yeah.
Well, thank you. So I think there's a lot of hype around AI right now, renewed hype around AI. Maybe we can just talk at a high level, why is AI so critical to keeping Palo Alto Networks safe and keeping our customers safe?
So maybe if we look a bit to how we've done security originally, we've taken security professionals. They looked at a sample, for example. They looked at some key characteristics, build a signature, and release that signature out. When you're looking at today, there's a lot more attacks, there's a lot more data, there's a lot more things to protect, and all these things make this into more of a data problem than just a standard security problem. Meaning that if you want to make actual impact and protect both Palo Alto Networks and our customers, you have to be on point with using AI, because that can go over a lot of data and process it and generate algorithms, instead of just trying to build specific signatures, handcrafted, and that solves one specific problem. You have to solve a lot of problems. So for that, you have to be a lot more efficient.
Yeah, so we talked about this in a previous session where we talked about how much data we ingest into Cortex. It's a tremendous amount of data on any given day. And really, the threats and indicators of potential compromise or malicious activity can hide in that data. So really, like you said, security is boiled down to now, it's really a big data problem. And I think you and I talked about it, humans aren't really suited to dealing with data at that scale, right? Correct?
Yeah, that's a good thing. And I think that talks a bit to what we're trying to do. And we're not just, you know, throwing data scientists at a problem and saying, okay, they know AI, they'd solve it, because you have to have also a security person solving it. And again, as I've said, doing it with just a security person, they would use, you know, security tools to try and solve the problem. And those tools are more fitted to solving something that they know and understand, and looking at the data they could. Merging these two together with a process that ties it together, and of course using AI algorithms, makes them a lot more efficient in solving security problems. And that's the approach we're taking here with Cortex.
So it's a team, right? You've got experts in the data science, you've got experts on the AI side, and then you've got the technology, you bring it all together, and hopefully you get outcomes that really drive good AI, yes?
Yeah, and again, maybe talking a bit about AI, I've referred maybe specifically to the algorithmic side of that thing. But it's not just algorithms. AI is more than that. AI is an approach. It's a philosophy. It's it's a process. It's people, and of course, technology. Tied together to create something. And again, it, as I've said, it's, it doesn't matter if it's machine made or man made. And that's the point. If there's the process of building correct AI algorithms, the result will be better than just, again, that side of the fence or that side of the fence.
Right. Well, maybe it would help our audience if we talked about specifically how we employ AI and ML technology within the Cortex suite. Maybe you can share some examples?
Yeah. Generally speaking, I think that with Cortex and with the learning we've done in the last couple of years, we've understood that trying to do just classical anomaly detection doesn't really work, because when you're looking at networks, at environments, you see a lot of anomalies, let's say a vulnerability scanner, and it looks anomalous, it does anomalous things, but it's not malicious. It's something that the IT team put there by design.
So the process of scanning for vulnerabilities is anomalous in its sense, but in its essence, but it's not malicious, yes?
Yeah.
Okay.
So that distinction led us to the point where we said you can't do anomaly detection and reach an outcome for the security operations center that is favorable enough. Meaning it might do some good things, but on its own, it's not enough to detect bad. So what we're doing, we're building supervised models, meaning that we're building a model that's trained to classify or prioritize, or depending on the subject, using labels and not just trying to find uncommon or abnormal, but trying to find that point between benign and malicious. And that creates a very different model. It's a very different process, of course, from an actual machine learning perspective. And the results are very, very different. And the outcomes are different for a SOC operation, for a security operations center.
So I assume this is really to filter down the noise and kind of put a focus on the things that are not only anomalous, but are specifically anomalous and potentially malicious. Is that the reason for the supervised approach?
Yeah, and maybe not even anomalous at all. Maybe they're, you know, hiding in plain sight, in a sense where it looks like something very common, but there's key characteristics which are unique to an attack, which might look from a statistical perspective, you know, common, but from a attacker perspective, they're unique. And that's where getting a data scientist and a security person working together, that's where that distinction happens.
So Yoni, we've talked a lot about AI for the purpose of anomaly detection and supervised learning for narrowing down, you know, what might actually be malicious. But you and I have spoken, we use AI pervasively throughout Cortex XDR and XIM. Maybe talk about some of the other areas we use AI as well, maybe prioritization, other things as well.
So our approach is to use AI where it's needed, meaning that if we can solve a problem without AI and it results in a good outcome, we don't have to use it. It's it adds complexity. There's problems with using AI, makes our time to market lower. You know, there's a lot of problems with it, but where it's needed, we use it, and specifically, we're sprinkling it pretty much all across our products, from protections on the agent, detection on the server side, to incident grouping and risk prioritization. And specifically around risk prioritization, what we've seen is that when looking at all of our data sets, all of the feedback we have, analysts are spending a lot of their time on the wrong incidents, meaning that they could have spent the same amount of time, but focusing on other incidents, which are potentially higher risk to the organization and result in a better security outcome for the organization they're working for. So what we've done, we've taken all of the feedback we have, we've taken all of the incidents we've seen, and we've built a model that tries to understand potentially what is the risk score for that incident. And that is leveraging all of the different data sets we have. So getting data from all of the sources, all of the alerts, all the profiling we're doing in the backend to pinpoint what should be the right score for that incident. And hopefully an analyst would sort by that risk score and result in a more optimized use of time for them when they're investigating.
Yeah. So an interesting use of AI in helping prioritize, but how do you help the SOC analysts or the head of the SOC trust the decisions that the AI is making? You've got now AI helping guide their efforts, but how do you help them have confidence in the decisions the AI is making in terms of prioritization?
That's a great question. The way we've built the model and our strategy around building models is, of course, building them supervised, as I've said. So firstly, every model that we do release has a security person and a data scientist looking at the results, understanding, you know, if they're good enough, validating that it makes sense. And that's why using supervised learning makes more sense than such models. Mm-hmm. So the model itself, we're making sure we're signing off on something that's great. Mm-hmm. But again, that's not enough. As you said, you still have to trust what we're doing.
Right.
And for that, we need to give you more visibility into what's going on behind the scenes of that model. Mm-hmm. So we've built another model that's looking at the original model and creating a set of explainability features, which are explanations to why we made that decision. So you don't have to blindly trust, let's say, score 90 or score 1. You can look at the reasons, and we provide them with a reasoning as to if it's, you know, hiring the score or lowering the score, depending on what we've seen behind the scenes.
Right.
And then you can build over time trust that we're making the right decisions, or of course provide us feedback if we're not on point.
Yeah, I love that feature where you can actually go in and say, is the score accurate for your organization? So great, you mentioned a couple of things. One, the effort you put into supervising the model, which is important to make sure that prioritization is accurate and people can trust it. And then two, and I've seen it in the product, the explainability is great. It kind of gives a natural language description of why the prioritization is what it is, which helps the analyst have confidence in that. So thank you for sharing those examples. Back on the AI hype cycle, if you will, there's been a lot of attention around large language models, ChatGPT, and everything that's going on there. I just wanted to get your sense. Is it hype? What do you see happening? Is this something you're investigating or using? Thoughts on LLM?
That's a big question. I think you can split it into a couple of parts. First is, let's say, the core security issues of creating new detections, solving core security problems. I think that there's some merit, there's some use. For example, DLP or phishing, there's a lot of potential uses there. I think it's going to revolutionize that in those industries. And I think for other things, people are maybe expecting this to change the way malware detection is working. I'm not as convinced, or at least not convinced yet, that this is going to do that. In a second part, there's generating attacks and generating malware. And I think there, again, when you go to phishing emails, it's doing an amazing job at generating those things. And generating malware is something that I think a lot of people are actively investigating. And there's some efforts that are successful, some that aren't.
Right.
But it would definitely lower the bar of an attacker, meaning that somebody with less experience can probably generate something a lot more sophisticated, which they couldn't do before that, because now they have code generation, you know, under their keyboard, and they don't have to know all the bits and bytes to do that. And lastly, I think there's a user experience piece, which is unrelated directly to security, but of course related to security as well, because we have a lot of productivity issues with security professionals. And I think potentially there's going to be impact where we can streamline a lot of activities that used to be manual and automate them with an LLM in place, or generate new interfaces which will improve the productivity of security operation centers.
Right. So LLM really is a double-sided coin. You've got it helping the adversaries actually get, you know, lower the bar for creating sophisticated malware. So that's not good for us. It makes the job more difficult for us as defenders, but hopefully also the ability for us to really leverage LLM to improve our productivity and how we respond to threats. Yoni, thank you so much. Thank you for taking the time to tell us about what your team does and how you are employing AI to keep Palo Alto Networks safe and to keep our customers safe. As always, it's been a fascinating conversation. And thank you for joining us again for another session of This Is How We Do It. We hope you'll continue to join us. In the next session, we'll be talking with Leroy Pereira, where we'll take a deep dive and look at how we do threat hunting within the SOC at Palo Alto Networks. Thank you for joining us.